Well, let me go ahead and say good evening to everyone. Good evening. Very thankful for another opportunity for us to come together to study the Word of God. And as we prepare our hearts to receive the Word this evening, as we discuss the very important topic of, is there anything left that we can trust? I would like to invite as much of you as are able to, let's kneel and let us have a word of prayer as we begin. Father in heaven, we are so grateful. You have been wonderfully kind to us by allowing us to have life, health, and strength today. You have blessed us, Lord, to come to the house of prayer where there's healing. And we're grateful that we have the privilege to hear your words, and you can allow your words to have its sanctifying effect upon our hearts. And Lord, so I pray that you'll please forgive us of our sins and that you'll grant us the presence of your Holy Spirit, and that he may come and open our eyes and help us to behold wondrous things out of your word. And these and all other blessings we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm very thankful that we have an opportunity to address a very important topic, which again deals with, is there anything else left that we can trust? We live in a world today where we have learned that the minds of men, the heart of men, are very deceitful. The Bible says deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And as a result of that, we certainly can't trust our hearts, because you would never trust anything that is deceitful or desperately wicked, would you? Well, obviously, we know we would not do that. So therefore, we can't trust our own hearts. We can't trust the things happening in politics. We are told what people want us to know. Did you know you can't even trust the news? The news is simply a medium that tells you what people want you to hear. And as a result of that, there's much behind the scenes that we know nothing about. And as a result of that, we cannot even trust sometimes what is coming right in front of our faces. There seems to be in our world today that there is nothing left that we can trust. But I'm thankful that there is something that we can still trust, even in these very last moments of Earth's history. And that is what I have the privilege of talking with you about tonight. I want you to draw your attention to the screen as we go ahead and consider, is there anything else left that we can trust? And what I want to submit to you right from the beginning, there is something, and that very thing is none other than the Word of God, which we call the Bible. The Bible, you will find, is a unique book, and it is very much a book separate from other religious books. When you think about all of the different books that exist today that are considered to be inspired books, holy books, and things of that nature, sometimes you do run into the place where you're wondering, how do I choose? How do I know which one is right? And you get to a point that you start to ask a very important question, which is, why the Bible? Why if there's so many options out there, why is it that I want to handpick this one? Why is it that I want to go ahead and trust the Bible instead of the other books? And even though there may be some of you in the room that says, well, the Bible is my book, it's for me, and I'm settled, you got to ask yourself this question. Why are you settled? Are you settled because your mother and father were settled? Are you settled because your pastor settled? Are you settled because somebody told you to be settled? Or are you settled because of what you have truly studied for yourself, researched for yourself, and have come to a conclusion for yourself that this truly is God's word written to humanity? And as a result of that, we all need to ask ourselves this question while we will also entertain this question on behalf of others. Why the Bible? Why should we consider this book above and beyond any of the other quote-unquote books that are in existence today? Now, one of the things we can also look at is, what does the Bible claim about itself? The Bible actually makes commentary, if you will, about itself that I think is beautiful and would fit for the very discussion we're having tonight. In fact, I want you to think about it this way. The Bible says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. Now, there's a few things you need to consider as we consider this verse. So think about the verse again. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. This is none other than the book 2 Timothy 3 and verse 16. But the thing I want you to consider is this. It says all scripture is given by inspiration of God. Now, the first thing that I like about this is it says how much scripture? All scripture. Now, if anyone knows anything, you would understand that when this was written, this was written in the days of the Apostle Paul. And the thing that's very interesting is that when the Apostle Paul went to areas like Lystra and Iconia and Lyconia, when he went to these places to minister, there were many individuals that did not believe in God. They did not believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. But there was a young man that did hear those words, and his name was Timothy. And it was Timothy that heard these words, and then when God was inspiring the Apostle Paul, the scribes during the time of Timothy would go ahead and write these very words. But this was before there was something called the New Testament. And this becomes a very important point, because there are some people today that call themselves New Testament Christians. Well, the thing, and sometimes the inference of that is, if I'm a New Testament Christian, then I believe that the only thing that applies to me today is the New Testament. And there are things in the Old Testament that are old, and it does not apply to me. Well, wait a minute. It says how many scriptures? It says all scripture. Was the New Testament written yet? No. So that means that this was really talking about the Old Testament. Now, go to the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3, and let me show you another piece of this verse that we would do well to consider. It's found in verse 17. In the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3, you will notice that in verse 17, it goes even further to show the relevance of the Old Testament to the believers in Christ. The Bible says in the book of 2 Timothy, and we're going to consider chapter 3, but now I want us to look again, verse 16 and 17. Notice what it says. It says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. And then it says it is profitable, beneficial. And it's beneficial for doctrine. That means teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be what? Perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. So the Old Testament, inclusive with the New Testament, is actually beneficial or profitable to us so that we can understand right from wrong, we can receive correction and give correction, and we can also receive instruction that we may experience God and His righteousness, and by the grace of God, become a man or a woman that becomes perfect, truly furnished to do all the works that God has called us to do. Now, when it says inspiration, it means God breathed. So the word inspiration means God breathed. The Bible, when it was put together, was not written in the Western English vernacular that we have today. The Bible, when it was put together, it was written in three original languages: Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. The majority of the Old Testament is Hebrew, 39 books, and then you have the other 27, which makes up the New Testament, which gives us our entirety of 66 books that makes up the Bible, the Protestant Bible. The majority of the Old Testament is Hebrew. But then there are certain portions in Ezra and in Daniel and in Job where you will find Aramaic. And then in the New Testament is Greek. So when you look up this Greek word here, inspiration, all scripture is given by inspiration, the Greek term is God breathed. Now we need to understand that. Was God going over a bunch of people and going and blowing on them? What does it mean when it says God breathed? Because we have to understand that. God breathed. Well, the Bible doesn't leave us aloof to this question. So notice, the Bible says in 2 Peter 1 and verse 21, it brings about more clarity. First and 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration, the breathing of God. God was breathing. But now look at 2 Peter 1:21. The Bible says prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Now watch that verse carefully. Holy men of God spake as they were what? Moved by the Holy Ghost. Now, one thing that you will know that you do every time you speak. You know what you do every time you speak? You breathe. Did you know that? Every single time you speak, you're breathing. So when the Bible says that all scripture came by inspiration, what does the word inspiration mean? God breathed. And one of the things we do when we speak is we breathe. So watch the text. So it says, holy men of God spake as they were what? Moved by the Holy Ghost. Now watch this. What does this moved by the Holy Ghost means? Notice the next verse. Here it is, that in 2 Samuel 23 and verse 2, it says the Spirit of the Lord, which is also the Holy Ghost. What did the Spirit of the Lord do? He spake. So notice, the Spirit of the Lord spake by me, and then it says, and his word was in my tongue. So when the Bible says all scripture was given by inspiration, it means that God breathed. But what's one of the things that we do when we're breathing? We are speaking. So God, through his Spirit, was speaking to the minds of men. And as the mind of men heard God speak, then they were able to speak the words of God, and then it was written. Are you following? This is the idea of how this book that we call the Bible literally came together. So this is what we need to understand. Every time we hear this term, inspiration, God breathed. Please don't make the mistake of thinking God was just blowing on people. God was not blowing on anybody. God was talking. God was speaking. And then as God was speaking, man heard what God spoke. And then as man heard what God spoke, man wrote. Who wrote? Man wrote. Now, you know one thing about man. If a man writes, it is possible that a man can make mistakes when he writes. You ever had a right thought but made the wrong mistake in your writing? Maybe you put a comma where it didn't belong. Maybe you put some level of a punctuation where it didn't belong. You understand? Now, why is that point important? Because I want you to understand from the beginning that what about the contradictions? Because let's face it, there's a reason why people don't believe the Bible. There are many reasons, in fact. But one of the reasons why is something called contradictions. People get to a point that they say, look, I don't believe the Bible. I don't want to hear this thing about the Bible, because at the end of the day, you can say God spoke and man wrote all you want. But at the end of the day, the bottom line is God contradicts himself, because there are contradictions in the Bible. And you will find that there are a lot of things that people call contradictions but are not. Have you paid attention to the sign? Doesn't that look like a contradiction? Do not enter, enter only. This is how a lot of people treat the Bible. They feel like it's giving two messages. It's not saying the same thing. It's contradicting itself. You understand? So this is how a lot of people look at the Bible. And as a result of that, they say, I don't want anything to do with this book. It contradicts itself. And therefore, it cannot be the word of God, because God certainly doesn't contradict itself. Well, I remember years back, man, I got a chance to talk with some brothers. You know, I've had the privilege of talking with people from so many religious backgrounds, and it's been a privilege. It really has. It has helped me to grow. I'm a very honest man with the word of God. If somebody shows me that I'm wrong, I will go back. I'll study and be honest with myself to look for truth. I have no bend towards any religion. I don't have a bend. I just want truth. That's all I want is truth. And I believe that the sooner we learn to not have a bend towards supporting our religion per se, but we have a bend simply of supporting the truth, you'll be amazed at how much truth God can show you. So here it is that I remember brothers would come to me and say all these different things, and they'd give me examples of so-called contradictions. You notice I said so-called. Because here are some things that individuals will say are quote-unquote contradictions that I want to give to you tonight, and let's consider it. So notice, some people need to understand, or people rather need to understand, the Bible is thought inspired, but not pen inspired. This is a very important point. When God was speaking those perfect words unto man, those words were perfect. The thought was perfect. But when man would begin to write, there were sometimes different things that were what you would classify as a possible imperfection, especially with translations. And this is why sometimes you have commas and you have words. You may have a misspelling of a certain word or things of that nature that may exist. But brothers and sisters, the Bible is thought inspired. The thought is consistent throughout scripture, even though there may be a punctuation that really wasn't there in the first place or shouldn't be there in the first place. Now watch this. Its words do not have to be repeated verbatim by other writers. I was talking with a dear Muslim friend, and one of the reasons why he liked the Quran in comparison to the Bible is because they believe that when the Prophet Muhammad and many others would go ahead and write the different things that were in the Quran, that it was actually written word for word, like it was verbatim. And they say because the Bible does not speak verbatim different points, that's the reason why it's a contradiction. Let me give an example. In Zechariah chapter 12 and verse 10, look at what the Bible says. And they shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. So this is the first time this statement was made, which was a messianic psalm. It's talking about what the Messiah was going to go through. He's going to be pierced. The people are going to look at him and they are going to mourn. The words that are used, they shall look upon me whom they have pierced. Now that's the exact words. But then later on, you'll find in John 19 and verse 37, the Bible says, and again, another scripture saith, they shall look on him whom they pierced. So somebody says, well, wait a minute, that's not verbatim. That's not exactly. It says they shall look upon me, but now it says on him. So they say that's a contradiction. Now, ladies and gentlemen, is this an example of statements being repeated verbatim? Yes or no? Obviously no. But is this an example of a statement being stated where the thought is consistent? Yes. So you notice thought inspiration in comparison to verbatim word for word inspiration. This is how some people look at the Bible and they say, if the Bible does not say it exactly how the other person said it, it's a contradiction. That is not true when we understand thought inspiration. It's the same thought. It's the same exact consistent thought, even though there are different words. You understand thus far? So let's notice this. Let's consider another point. Some people say, because a portion of a text is missing does not mean that manipulation has taken place. Sometimes, you know, if one statement is in the Bible one way, one place, and then if the statement is made at another time, but a certain portion is cut out, individuals say, see, that's manipulation of scripture, and therefore that is a contradiction. The Bible can't be trusted. Well, that's not true. Let me give you a really good example of this. You'll remember in Isaiah 61, the Bible says in Isaiah 61 verses 1 and 2, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. Now, this again was a prophecy that was given in the book of Isaiah. Well, when this prophecy was given in the book of Isaiah, later on, Jesus now comes on the scene. When Jesus came on the scene, he was baptized. After Jesus was baptized, he then goes into the synagogue, as was his custom. When he went into the synagogue, do you know that he opened up the scroll of Isaiah and began to read this very statement? But notice what the Bible says he did say versus what he didn't say. And the question is this a contradiction? Notice, Jesus is now speaking. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, what part did Jesus leave cut out? He left out the part and the day of vengeance of our God. Now go to Luke 4 and let me show you how important this text is. Watch this now. In Luke, the fourth chapter, let me show you how important this text of scripture is, because you and I need to consider it. Luke, the fourth chapter, we're looking right there. We're up to verse 19 thus far, but I want you to pay attention to what it says as we look at verses 20 and 21. In Luke 4, we finish at verse 19, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. I want you to notice what it says as we look at verses 20 and 21. Are you there? Now notice what the Bible says in verses 20 and 21. And he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister, and sat down. And the eyes of them all that were there, and the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he says something powerful in verse 21. Verse 21, it says, and he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. So notice, when Jesus was repeating the words of Isaiah the prophet, he was actually using those words to explain whose ministry? His ministry. Now, when Jesus came to the earth in his first advent, did he come to take vengeance? He did not come to take vengeance. And that's why he deliberately left out this last piece. Because in his first advent, it was not his mission to bring vengeance. But 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, let's turn there. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, we do see something. Go to the book of 2 Thessalonians. Notice what the Bible says as we consider chapter 1. In 2 Thessalonians, we're turning to chapter 2. Chapter 1. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Now notice what the Bible says here, and this is beautiful, because now everything kind of, you know, comes together. Notice what the Bible says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 And when you get there, just say amen. Notice what the Bible says. It says in verse 8, in flaming fire, what is God going to do? Take vengeance. So notice, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. So does the Bible talk about a day of vengeance? But when does it come? Notice, it states when this flaming fire is going to come. Now, the first time God destroyed the world, he destroyed it with a flood. But the second time, God said that he's going to destroy it with fire. It is at the time when the world is destroyed by fire, that is when God is going to bring about the day of vengeance. So when Christ came in his first mission, he was not there to do the full work of Isaiah 61. He was there to do the majority of the work up until this point. But it's at his second coming, where 2 Thessalonians 2, right there as we look at verses 8 through 11, it then shows that Christ is going to come, and that's when the flaming fire, and that's when the vengeance of the Lord and the brightness of his coming shall destroy the wicked and all those other things. But that's at his second coming. That's why Christ left that out. It was not to try to deceive. So therefore, there are things that we can read in the Bible sometimes where we say, hey, wait a minute, that doesn't look exactly right. And we call it a contradiction, but with careful study, what appears to be a contradiction is actually truth in its most beautiful form. So there are people today that literally say, I don't believe the Bible because of these type of reasons. But the more that we study carefully, we begin to see, no, the Bible's not contradicting itself. The Bible is actually very balanced in its presentations. There's a time for an application here and an application there. So therefore, when we think about it, remember this point right here. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and what? Now that's what you will read in a King James Version. Now, is there a problem with this text? You said no. Question. Does there appear to be a problem with this text? What's the problem? Replenish. I remember when I used to, be in hip hop, and I remember we used to walk around with a lot of these brothers who were called Nuwabians, and they were basically the graduated movement from the Five Percenters. There used to be a group called the Five Percenters back in the days. They were offshoot Islam, they were offshoots from Muslims or Islam. And what they would do is they would go around, saying that 85% of the world is ignorant. Therefore, they call them the ignorant 85. And then you had 10% of the world were wicked and basically devils in human form. And they would say, well, that's the people in government and police officers and all this other stuff. And then they would say, and then there's the PRTs, the poor righteous teachers, which represented only 5%. And therefore, this is how the term 5%ers came about. Well, once the 5% movement started to disappear, they graduated to another movement called Nuwabians, the Nuapu movement, led by a man named Malachi Z. York, who today is in prison for literally molesting children. But nevertheless, they were part of this big group, and there's still some of them that are, there's still remnants of some of these guys today. And sometimes you'll see them by subways with little books, and they talk about Eastern religions and the holy tablets and all these things. Well, anyhow, I remember I was talking with one brother, and he came to me and he said, do you believe in the Bible? I said, yes, I do. He said, oh, really? I said, yes, sir. He said, well, there are other books that are inspired. I said, how do you figure? He said, because your Bible proves that Adam and Eve were not the first people created. I said, well, how do you figure that? He said, the reason why is because, think about it. How could God say, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth? You can't replenish anything unless something was already there. I said, wow, that's a pretty good argument, my friend. I said, but what language was the Bible written in? And then he said, well, Hebrew, Aramaic. I said, very good. So in Genesis, would we agree that's Hebrew? He said, yes. I said, have you ever looked up the Hebrew word for replenish? He said, no, I did not. I said, well, let me show you. So therefore, I put it up. The word, the Hebrew word, male, what it means is to fill. What does it mean? To fill. Now, if you didn't know the original language, would this not look like a contradiction? Do you understand that? You see, there are a lot of things that can appear like contradictions that with careful study, you realize it was not a contradiction. When God was saying to Adam and Eve, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth, the Hebrew male, it simply meant to fill the earth. So when it came to that, God was saying, be fruitful, multiply and fill the earth. Now, if God says fill the earth, is it a contradiction anymore? No, it is not. You understand? This is why when you study the Bible, when an individual studies the Bible, I would encourage you, you need to become familiar with the original languages. And if you are thinking, are you telling me I got to go to theology school and I got to sign up and take classes for the next year or two? No. That is not what I'm saying. You know what I'm saying? What I'm saying is that you might want to do what I did, 22 years ago. I remember that one of the first Bibles I ever bought was something called the Hebrew Greek Key Study Bible. Did you know that's available in book and Bible houses today? You can get something called the Hebrew Greek Key Study Bible. And you can literally have it, and right there with the Bible in your hand, you can actually look up any word in its original Hebrew, Aramaic, or Greek language, and you can understand what it means. I'll give you a quick little story. One time I was talking with another Muslim brother, and he came to me and said, I don't believe in the Bible. I don't believe in Christianity. Christianity is with paganism. I said, how do you figure that? He said, because one minute you Christians say that Jesus is God. I said, that's right. Amen. Jesus himself said it. He said, where did Jesus say it? Jesus never said it. Other people said it, but Jesus didn't. I said, John 8 and verse 58. Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am. Jesus called himself God. I like to tell that to my Jehovah's Witness friends especially, because it was in Exodus 3 and verse 14 that God told Moses, he said, Moses, go ahead and tell Pharaoh, let my people go. And Moses said, Lord, who should I say sent me? And God said in Exodus 3:14, tell them I am that I am hath sent you. Did you know what the word I am means? It means Yahweh, Y-H-W-H. There were no vowels in the original Hebrew. Yahweh. Later on when they added vowels, it would go from Yahweh to Yahweh. And then it went from Yahweh to Jehovah. And then it went from Jehovah to Lord. So therefore, when God said, I am, he called himself Jehovah. Jesus said in John 8, 58, before Abraham was, I am. So what did Christ call himself? Jehovah. I love sharing that with my Jehovah's Witness friends. Because they love to try to tell us that Jesus is not Jehovah. But no, Jesus said, yes, I am. And if you don't believe it, just look at verse 59. The Jews knew what Jesus meant. Jesus didn't say before Abraham was, I existed. Jesus said before Abraham was, I am. He called himself Jehovah. And the way you know it is because Jewish people knew when a man calls himself God, you know what you got to do to him. You got to stone him. And when you read John 8, 59, the Bible says after Jesus said, I am, they picked up stones to kill him. They understood who Jesus called himself. Well, again, I was talking with this Muslim brother, and he said, well, you call Jesus God. I said, that's right. He says, but then how could God be begotten? I said, what do you mean? He says, well, you know the popular Christian verse, the verse that everybody knows, even the people who don't study the Bible. Everybody knows John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only what? Begotten son. Well, he said, how could God be begotten? That is blasphemy. And I said, well, I would agree with you if the word begotten meant what you think it means. He said, what do you mean? I said, have you ever looked up the original word for begotten? He said, no, I have not. I said, well, what you would understand is that there are actually two words in the Greek language for begotten. One is called monogeneo, and another one's called monogenes. Well, the word monogeneo means brought forth or created. So that's how a lot of people interpret John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, his son who was brought forth or created. And that is the area of blasphemy, because that's what individuals say, how could Jesus be created if he's God? But did you know that the Greek word in John 3:16 is not monogeneo? It's actually monogenes. I said, my brother, I said, have you ever looked up the word monogenes? He said, no, I never have in my life. What does it mean? I said, monogeneo means brought forth. I said, monogenes means the only one like me. The only one of its kind. In other words, if I could paraphrase John 3:16, John 3:16 was actually saying, for God so loved you that he gave the only one like him. Amen. That you don't have to perish, but have everlasting life. He gave the only one of his kind. that you don't have to perish, but have everlasting life. You see, sometimes the reason why people think the Bible contradicts itself is because they don't understand how it was put together and they do not understand its method of study. But once we understand these simple principles, there are a lot of things that appear like contradictions that are not contradictions at all. And so it is that all we got to do is understand God was not saying replenish the earth, indicating that there were people before. God was simply saying, fill the earth, my children. He said that to Adam and Eve in Genesis 1, and he said that to Noah in Genesis 9. God says, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. So the Bible is consistent and it is trustworthy. Now there are questions like, can the Bible we have today be trusted? How do I know the Bible we have today can be trusted? Now, that's a good question, so let's build on it. Notice, there was a wonderful little cave called Qumran in the east, and what happened was there were some archaeologists that were there, and they started to take some rocks as they were entering the caves doing research, looking for old ancient relics. And what they did was they started throwing some rocks in the caves, and when they threw the rocks, they heard something break like pottery. And when they heard something break and it sounded like pottery, they were like, man, what is that? They went inside, and when they went inside, they saw all of these, you know, vases, if you will, these nice little beautiful type, well handcrafted type units that was holding scrolls of the Bible in it. And when they found it, they were like, wait a minute, these are scriptures that date back as far, and literally they were doing this because it was incredible. Let me put it up and show you. It states, the Dead Sea Scrolls are a collection of 981 texts discovered between 1946 and 1956 at Kirbet Qumran in the West Bank. They were found inside caves about a mile inland from the northwest shore of the Dead Sea, from which they derived their name, the Dead Sea Scrolls. So this is what was found. So when they found these Dead Sea Scrolls, what they started to do was do a little bit more research. And, you know, many of them look like this. And as they were reading these different portions, they realized, wow, these are all sorts of Bible verses. Literally, this is what they found. They found 39 divisions in the Psalms. They found 33 chapters of Deuteronomy. They found something called the first book of Enoch, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Then there was the book of Genesis, 24 books, 22 chapters in Isaiah, 18 chapters in Exodus. And I mean, literally, it was just going through. They found 10 of the major prophets' writings. So what they did was they realized, and this was beautiful because when they found it, it dated so far back that they were able to compare it to the modern translations we have today. And do you know when they compared it to the modern translation, especially the King James Version, do you know they found that the King James Version was 98.33% accurate with Old Testament scripture? 1.67, literally 1.67% inaccurate, and what they found in the inaccuracies was punctuations. Can you imagine that? So therefore, can we trust the Bible that we have today, especially the King James Version? The answer is yes. So that's why the Bible says the grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of God shall stand how long? Forever. God is not going to let the devil get the advantage up on us to keep his word hidden. God always makes a way that he will go ahead and allow his words that are hidden in the dark to eventually come up in the light. I can imagine that angels were guiding those rocks, that when those brothers were throwing those rocks, those angels were just boop, knocking it and boom, let it hit inside there because the angels wanted them to hear that pottery break so they could go in and discover the words of God. So therefore, can the Bible today that we have be trusted? The answer is absolutely yes. Now watch this. What about the lost books? You know, a lot of people talk about that. I don't know if you ever heard of these things. I've had the privilege of being around, so I get to hear a lot. So a lot of people talk about the lost books, the lost book of Enos, the lost book of Barnabas, the lost book of Enoch, and like we saw, the first book of Enoch, and all these things. What about these lost books? Somebody's deceiving us, many would say. Well, let's consider some things. Let's think about it. What about the so-called lost books? So we have all of these books that are out there that individuals call the lost books. And they say these books should be accepted as inspiration too. Well, let's consider some things. Number one, let's think about it this way. Did you know that the Bible itself acknowledges books that were written by other prophets? The Bible itself acknowledges these things. Think about it. The Bible talks about all these verses. In Numbers 21 and verse 14, there's something called the Book of the Wars of the Lord. Literally, Numbers 21, verse 14. Wherefore it is said in the Book of the Wars of the Lord, what he did in the Red Sea and in the brooks of Ammon. So notice, there were other books that were written. The Bible acknowledges that. How about book of Jasher. That's in Joshua chapter 10 and verse 13. It says, and the sun stood still and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven. So there's somebody named Jasher who also recorded that the Bible says that the sun stood still. Then you got Nathan the prophet. Notice, and Nathan is what? A prophet. So notice, Nathan the prophet also wrote books. The Bible says in 1 Chronicles 29:29, now the acts of David the king, first and last, behold, they are written in the book of Samuel the seer. Now we do have 1 and 2 Samuel, but it says, and in the book of Nathan the prophet. Now don't miss that. That actually is your key point of understanding these other books. Notice what it said again and get the point. Here's what it says. Now the acts of David. So notice, David did a whole bunch of acts, right? Look at what it says. Now the acts of David the king, first and last, behold, they are written in the book of Samuel the seer. Now in 1 and 2 Samuel, do we hear about the acts of David? Yes, we do. So notice, it says, and in the book of Nathan the prophet. Do we have a book called the book of Nathan? No, we don't. But in the book of Nathan, as well as the book of Samuel, what's written in it? The acts of David. Now, watch this. Then there was Shemaiah the prophet. That's in 2 Chronicles 12:15. Now the acts of Rehoboam, first and last, are they not written in the book of Shemaiah the prophet, of Edo the seer, concerning genealogies? And there were wars between Rehoboam and Jeroboam. But question, does not the book of 2 Chronicles also record the acts of Rehoboam and Jeroboam? So notice this. Keep that in mind now. Now, book of Jehu. It says in 2 Chronicles 20 and verse 34, now the rest of the acts of Jehoshaphat, first and last, behold, they are written in the book of Jehu, the son of Hanani, who is mentioned in the book of the kings of Israel. Question. If the acts of men are already recorded in the books that are in the Bible, then if Nathan, Jehu, Asher, or anybody else, if they just simply have duplicates, is there a necessity for their writings to also be in the Bible? You see, what you need to understand is that even though the Bible acknowledges that there were other books written, there's only one, two things that other books can do. Confirm what the Bible has already said, or contradict what the Bible has already said. Now, if it confirms it, do we need it? No, because we have sufficient. But if it contradicts, should we have it? No, because then that's error. You understand? This is why, even with Jesus, did you know the Bible clearly says in the book of John? Forgive me that this is there. It should be John 21. It should be actually John 21. It states, and there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. We think that we have the whole life story and the acts of Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, if every act and every miracle and every work that Christ did on earth was recorded, as the Bible says, God supposes there would not even be a book that could contain it. Jesus was a hard-working man. So therefore, when we talk about the so-called lost books, brothers and sisters, we need not fear. There's no such thing as lost books. What happens is, all the other books, they can only do one of two things: contradict what the Bible says, or confirm what the Bible has already said. And if it confirms it, we don't need extra because we have sufficient. You know, the Bible teaches a lot about sufficient. We learned last week that even when we eat food, we should only eat that which is sufficient. And so it is. And remember, the Bible is considered in the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah says that he considered God's word more than food. So the same way we only eat a sufficient amount of food, the only thing we need is a sufficient amount of word. And we have everything we need to learn how to get from earth to the heavenly Canaan. So therefore, the Bible is fully and completely trustworthy, to the point that even Jesus, how did Jesus demonstrate his confidence and belief in Scripture? Think about it. The Bible goes on to say, Jesus said very clearly, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone. It is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. It is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Jesus himself relied on the word so that he could resist temptation. That's a model and an example for every Christian, because we learn that a Christian is someone who follows the example of Christ. So Jesus himself made a powerful statement. He said, thy word is is truth. And you know what truth does? It makes people free from the bondage of sin. And therefore, Christ wanted to point us to his words that if we accept them by faith and live them by the power of the indwelling Christ, we can experience freedom and victory over any bondage of sin that is in your life today. So therefore, the Bible is fully trustworthy. Why? Because Jesus himself trusted it. And even the world at large today, even those who don't believe that Jesus is the Messiah, many of them know that he was a wise, wise teacher in Israel. So these are the words of a wise man, but we know this is the word of God himself. Now, there are other things that we can consider that definitely makes it clear that the Bible is fully and completely trustworthy. Fully and completely trustworthy. Think about it this way. In Isaiah 42, 8 and 9, God puts himself on the line, if you will. He says, I am the Lord. I am the Lord. New things do I declare before they spring forth, I tell you of them. So God literally says, look, prove me. I'm going to tell you before it comes to pass. And then when it comes to pass, you may believe. John 14, 28. He says in Isaiah 46, 9 and 10, I am God declaring the end from the beginning and from the ancient times the things that are not yet done. If there is one thing that makes the Bible accurate, is its fulfillment of prophecy. And this is why we should be, Christians, especially in the last days, we should be vehement students of prophecy. The more that we understand prophecy is we can help people understand that God has said these things before they came to pass so that we might believe his words. Because if he was right on this point, then that means he's right on this point, and that means he's also right on the points yet to come in the very near future. It's a beautiful thing, friends. I'm telling you the truth. It's a beautiful thing that when the news media is not telling me everything, it's a beautiful thing when mankind cannot be trusted. It's a beautiful thing that when my own heart cannot be trusted, that I can go to the sure word of prophecy and that I can put my trust in what God has said. It's a comfort in these very last moments in Earth's history, and God wants you to have that comfort. So therefore, think about it. Bible prophecy confirms the inspiration of Scripture as they come to pass. Now, watch these following examples. Just think about it. The Bible prophesied four world empires to arise: Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. That was in Daniel chapters 2, 7, and 8. Now, I remember going to school and literally learning about this in secular school. I grew up in the public school system. I did not grow up privileged like some of you folks growing up in Christian schools. I grew up in the public school system. I grew up in the belly of the beast. And I remember that I would learn about Medo-Persia. I actually learned about Greece. I used to eat candies called Alexander the Great. And that was about the extent of my knowledge of Alexander the Great. He was a nice, sweet, lemon-flavored candy. And that was all that I knew about Alexander the Great. And then here it is, next thing I'm studying. I'm like, wait a minute. He was that first horn on the he-goat? Are you serious? I mean, that stuff blew me away when I discovered that. I was like, man, I went to school and learned this stuff. But it never made a connection, you understand? So here it is that it's incredible to see how the Bible prophesied of the succession of nations, and every single one of them came in their exact order. But then outside of that, number B, or letter B, Cyrus. Did you know that God actually said Cyrus was to be the warrior to capture Babylon? Do you know that history today literally records that Cyrus was the one to do it? It was written in Isaiah 45. God himself said, I have appointed Cyrus. God even said, Cyrus is my servant. And God says, I'm going to have him, and he's going to be the instrument that's going to take Babylon captive. And here we are in our little Encyclopedia Britannicas, and we go ahead and read about when Medo-Persia took over Babylon, and lo and behold, Cyrus. Right there. I mean, that's incredible. God says, I saw that coming. I was the one who told you before it came to pass, so that when it came to pass, you might believe. But it gets even deeper than that. Then you had after Babylon's destruction. Did you know the Bible says it would never be inhabited again? That's what we looked at last night. That's why we know the Babylon that the book of Revelation 14 is talking about has to be a spiritual one, because there's still people in it. But the Bible prophesied about the literal Babylon that there would never be an inhabitant there again. The only thing that's going to be there is snakes and lions and all the other creatures. That's it. And to date, I love this text because literally you can go ahead and test God, if you will. Individuals can actually test or prove him and see, is he really saying what he's saying? You can go right now to the Middle East and look at where Babylon was located. And to date, in 2014, nobody lives there. To date. God says, because I put my word on it. And my word, God says in Isaiah 55, 11, never comes back to me void. Isn't that powerful? Powerful. Then it goes on, letter D, earth-shaking calamities and fear toward the end of time. Ladies and gentlemen, are you paying attention to the news? Are you looking at what's happening with earthquakes by sea and land? Are you looking at what's happening in the calamities? Our world is in a mess. And people are perplexed, filled with fear because they don't know what's coming. But you know what? The children of God know. Why? Because we have the word. We know exactly what's coming. Even when individuals say peace and safety, the Bible says be careful because that's when sudden destruction is coming. We have insight, and that insight comes through scripture. Lo and behold, inspiration goes on to say in letter F, moral degeneracy and decline of spirituality in the last days. And we read that in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 to 5. In the last days, perilous times shall come. Men will become lovers of their own selves, proud, blasphemous, boasters, and arrogant, disobedient to parents, and all these other things. Bible prophecy is imperative in these last moments in Earth's history, because if anyone doubts that the Bible is the Word of God, you will be amazed at how Bible prophecy can turn an unbeliever into a believer. How do we know? Because again, Jesus' words, behold, I tell you before it comes to pass, so that when it comes to pass, you might believe. You would be amazed at how many unbelievers would become believers if we simply faithfully understood and taught Bible prophecy. Now, not only that, can we expect scientific statements made in the Bible to be accurate? Did you know the Bible is also last week we learned that the Bible is an incredible health book. Is that right? Amen. We learned last week that the Bible is the best health book in the market. And you can find it for free. You don't have to even pay anything for it most times. You can even find them in hotels. And here it is, that the Bible is not only a phenomenal health book, but it's also an incredible science book. You will be amazed. The Bible says in Psalms 119th division in 160, thy word is true from the beginning. Then the Bible goes on to say in John 16:13, the Spirit will guide you into all truth. And when you think about it, if we were to look at some of the scientific evidences, you would be amazed at how God knew things well before the scientists today that are heralded as great scientists and researchers and founders. Many of these individuals wouldn't get that credit if people were simply studying the Bible. Example, the Bible says, he hangeth the earth upon nothing. That was in Job 26 and verse 7. So this scientific fact is from Job, that the Bible's oldest book. So literally, the Bible already showed that the earth was already being sustained upon nothing, of which many people call simply today gravity, and of course being caught in the midst of the constellations. Then in Isaiah 40 and verse 22, he sitteth upon the what? Circle of the earth. So well before individuals discovered that the earth was not flat but round, God says, well, I said it way before these events took place. God already knew that the earth was a circle. Then, Job 28 and verse 25, it says, to make the weight for the winds. Long before scientists knew, God said, air has weight. God knew all of these things. It's just how we approach the scripture. Some of us are so narrow-minded when we read scriptures that we walk away with a narrow view. But the problem is that the Word of God is very broad when it teaches truth, whether it's scientific, health-based, historical, and certainly prophetic. God says, my Word is complete. And if the people would simply receive it in their hearts, oh, what a blessing it would be unto them. So therefore, the Bible makes it clear. Look at this. Our biblical health principles tuned to the 21st century. God says, cover body waste with dirt. God taught hygienic principles that if we were to follow them today, we would not suffer with some of these respiratory diseases and all these things that we have. Did you know that one of the key things that we have a lot of times in many of our homes are respiratory challenges that are directly connected to animals who are living in our homes and their fecal matter is not covered? Did you know that? The Bible says, literally in Deuteronomy 23, did you know that God, I want you to one day read those verses carefully. God literally told the children of Israel, he says, I want you to keep your camp holy. He didn't call it clean, he said holy. But what he meant was clean. That's why cleanliness is next to holiness. And here it is, God says, keep your camp holy. And he says, and I want you that when you eat, the King James Version says, when you ease thyself abroad. That's a real King James way of saying doing number two. And God says, when you ease yourself abroad and you defecate, God says, dig a hole, let it go down into the dirt. And then God says, and then cover it. He says, because I am a holy God and I walk in the midst of your camp. And he says, and if I walk in the midst of your camp and see your fecal matter sticking up above the ground, he said, I will not defend you when your enemies come to overtake you. Literally, you read that. That's in Deuteronomy 23, verses 12 and 13 and 14. You read that. So God takes hygiene very, very seriously. And therefore, my friends, we would do the well to do the same. And this is why I always say to people who got these animals in your home. Animals are not supposed to be in your house. You know, I'm scaling back to last week on health, but I'm just letting you know, animals, with their dander, and even though they know how to lick their fur and all that stuff, they're not really clean. They're clean to them, but not to us. And a lot of times they carry this filth and all these things, the dander and all these things inside of our homes, and we're breathing it in. They get to go to the bathroom and their filth is not covered, and we wonder why some of us are suffering with these respiratory challenges and all these things. We're not being hygienic, ladies and gentlemen. So therefore, God, he knew this way back from the beginning. Think about it. The Bible provision of Moses' day that body waste should be buried was 3,500 years ahead of its time and saved countless thousands of Jewish lives. Major problems still arise when sanitation is not properly handled. So therefore, God was keeping the health of his people in mind when he gave what's called hygienic laws. Then not only that, think about it. Neither let us commit fornication. That was in 1 Corinthians 10:8. Think about how many diseases literally would not even exist if we simply followed this instruction. Think about it. To a large degree, AIDS would not exist. There would be no such thing as sexually transmitted diseases. There'd be no such thing as rape. Rape would literally be eliminated. Think about that. If we simply followed, thou shalt not commit adultery, or in this context, neither let us commit fornication. Think about that. Think about how much the world would have been preserved. How many marriages would be sustained? God had all these things in mind when he thought about us. Why? Because he loved us. How about this one? Are biblical health principles tuned to the 21st century when it comes to alcohol? The Bible makes it very clear to leave alcoholic beverages alone. Wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby are not wise. Did you know that if individuals followed this simple program of not consuming alcohol, not even in moderation, think about the drastic changes that would happen in our society. Millions of alcoholics becoming sober, respectable citizens. Millions of families reunited. Millions of broken homes mended. Multiplied thousands of lives saved by sober drinking. Thousands of government, business, and professional leaders making clear-minded decisions. Then billions of dollars available for humanitarian use. Just imagine what could take place if individuals would simply follow the simple instructions of God to leave alcoholic beverages alone. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, the Bible, it literally is the answer to all of life's problems. That's why it's the diabolical plan of Satan to get us to do everything and trust everything but the Bible. I hope that as we're progressing through these studies, we're seeing why the devil works so hard to make sure we don't believe in the Bible. Because if we actually believed in the Bible and lived according to these words, ladies and gentlemen, happy are you. So watch this now. Are the historical statements of the Bible accurate? These, again, are some questions people ask. Well, we talked about it with Cyrus. We talked about it with the nations. But notice, I, the Lord, speak the truth. I declare what is right. You remember in Genesis 6:17, and behold, I, even I, do bring a flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh, wherein is the breath of life from under heaven, and everything that is in the earth shall die. Remember, God talked about the flood, right? Did you know, brothers and sisters, that there is compelling evidence to show that God's word is true, even as it relates to the flood? And there are people today who say, no, this stuff is not true. But think about it. If the flood was not true, if the flood never took place, then the question is, how do you explain this? Marine fossils high above sea level. Think about this. Did you know it is beyond dispute among geologists that on every continent, how many continents? Every continent, we find fossils of sea creatures in rock layers, which today are high above sea level. For example, we find marine fossils in most of the rock layers in the Grand Canyon. This includes the topmost layer in the sequence, the Khabib limestone exposed at the rim of the canyon, which today is approximately how high? Brothers and sisters, how in the world do you explain marine fossils encased in rocks 7,000 to 8,000 feet above sea level? How in the world did they get there? This is literally where the geologists are baffled. They can't answer it. This is where the evolutionists are literally stuck. They can't answer it. How can you explain that all these marine creatures are 7,000 to 8,000 feet above sea level? and encased in rocks. The question is, how did they get there? They don't have an answer, but guess what? God does. You understand? Watch this now. All these sediments that we see in the mountains. I was in Utah. When I was in Utah working there, it was amazing to watch how the mountains and everything was covered. And you see all these lines of sediment all here. What do these things mean? Put it this way. Rapidly deposited sediment layers spread across vast areas. Consider the sedimentary rock layers exposed in the walls of the Grand Canyon in northern Arizona. This sequence of layers is not unique to that region of the USA. For more than 50 years, geologists have recognized that these strata belong to six mega sequences, very thick, distinctive sequences of sedimentary rock layers that can be traced right across North America. How did these layers get there if there was no flood, no sea level that got so high to cause that, no matter how high? Again, look at it. Think about how high this is. This is thousands upon thousands of feet above sea level, but yet the sedimentation, all the linings go all the way up to the top. How did it get there? This is what the geologists, they can't answer, but we know the answer. The Word of God has already told us. Then you have all these different, what they call graveyards around the world, all these dead animals. But here's where it gets interesting. Hundreds of thousands of marine creatures were buried with amphibians, spiders, scorpions, millipede, insects, and reptiles in a fossil graveyard at Montceau-les-Mines, France, and more than 100,000 fossil specimens representing more than 400 species have been recovered from a shale layer associated with coal beds in the Maison Creek area near Chicago. This spectacular fossil graveyard includes ferns, insects, scorpions, and tetrapods buried with jellyfish, mollusks, crustaceans, and fish, often with soft parts exquisitely preserved. At Florizont, Colorado, a wide variety of insects, freshwater mollusks, fish, birds, and several hundred plant species, including nuts and blossoms, are buried how? Together. Bees and birds have to be buried rapidly in order to be so well preserved. So notice, the question is simply this. Notice in many of these examples how marine and land-dwelling creatures are found buried together. How could this have happened unless the ocean waters rose and swept over the continents in a global catastrophic flood? There's no way, brothers and sisters, these things could have happened. You see, I'm not getting too deep in science, but we do have to pay attention to it. There are all sorts of proofs throughout this world that provides more than enough evidence that God was right. And God wanted to let these evidences be laid out for us so that we might believe. Now we press even further. One of the greatest miracles of the Bible is its unity. I mean, think about it. These people come from massive backgrounds. The 66 books of the Bible were written on three continents, in three languages, by about 40 different people, kings, shepherds, scientists, attorneys, an army general, fishermen, priests, and a physician, over a period of about 1,500 years, on the most controversial subjects, by people who in most cases had never met, and by authors whose education and background varied greatly. I'm amazed at how John the Revelator could speak so accurately to the prophecies of Daniel, and these brothers never met each other. Literally, Revelation is an absolute unfolding of the book of Daniel. How is it that these two men were able to be so incredibly accurate and they never met one another and their books don't skip a beat? Literally, Daniel and Revelation are totally and completely sister books, one to another. This was put together not by accident, but by prophetic design. Then it goes on. Yet though it seems totally inconceivable, the 66 books maintain harmony with each other, and often new concepts on a subject are expressed, but these concepts do not undermine what other Bible writers say on the same subject. It's kind of like the Old and New Testament. When you look at the Old and New Testament, some people put them together as if they're fighting, but they're really not. The Old Testament is simply the New Testament concealed, and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. So therefore, when we look at this, all we have to do is consider. And beginning at Moses, the New Testament, this is in the New Testament, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he, which was Jesus, expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning who? Himself. Then it goes on to say, for he, which was Apollos, vigorously refuted the Jews publicly, showing from the scriptures that Jesus is the Christ. And remember, in the days of the book of Acts, was there a New Testament? No, there was only the Old Testament. And that's why I see some of you taking pictures, you want to take a picture of this right here. This is sweet. This is beautiful. What evidence for Bible inspiration emerges when we compare Old Testament prophecies of the coming Messiah with the New Testament happenings in the life of Jesus? Literally, prophecy, born in Bethlehem, Old Testament, Micah 5. Matthew 2, verse 1, he was born in Bethlehem. Born of a virgin, Isaiah 7, 14, Matthew 1, 18 to 23, born of a virgin. Literally, it goes down the list, and all throughout, they're all prophecies concerning the Messiah, and then the New Testament confirms this. You know who needs to see this? Our Hebrew Israelite friends, our Jewish brothers and sisters. Because today, are they still looking for a Messiah? Yes, they are. But if we could show them prophetically what the Bible had said in the Old Testament, which they accept as inspired, and then show them, look, do you really think that all of this is by accident? That the New Testament is holistically and completely accurate in the revelation of the life of Jesus in every single one of these Old Testament prophecies. Brothers and sisters, this is not an accident. It was all put together by design. What great advantage does a person have who accepts the Bible as God's inspired word? Well, let's think about it. Number one, David says, I understand more than the ancients because I keep thy precepts. I promise you, the more that you understand the Bible is the better you'll understand science, math, history, English, and all the other subjects that are popular, obviously, in our schools. You'll be amazed at how articulate. There is nothing that will expand the mind like the study of Scripture. And the more that you understand the words of God, you'll become articulate in things that are happening in our world today. And that's when we can fulfill 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 26, when the Bible says, let all things be for edifying. You can edify people now when you sit down and you talk to them and you expound on the very words of God. The Bible says, thou hast made me wiser than mine enemies. I guarantee you, study the Bible. You start studying the Word of God, you will be amazed that no matter how much your enemies come together against you, their weapons will not prosper. God will give you wisdom, and He will show you how to deal even with your enemies to the point that sometimes you will even confound your enemies. Not only that, the Bible goes on to say, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my thoughts higher than your thoughts. Can you imagine that the Bible reveals the Word of God? And when you enter into the Word of God, you're entering into the thoughts of God, the mind of God, which is higher than the things of this earth. Our minds will be elevated, and as a result of beholding the words of God, you will not behave like the common man. I believe in these last days we need to do it. We are living in a time where our patience is always being tested. We're living in a time where people are always trying to pull the beast out of us to get us to go ahead and act out ungodly. And you and I got to know how to hold ourselves. And I say this with all due respect. You know, I really do. I really do. But I was talking with a police officer. And as I was talking with this police officer, he was a brother that was part of the same faith that I'm part of. And we were together talking one day. And I said, man, what do you think about all these brutalities that are happening with police officers and a lot of these young black men being gunned down and all these things? I said, what's your thoughts on it? And he said, well, you tell me your thoughts first. He was a smart man. I said, I'll be honest with you. I said, I hate seeing anybody get gunned down, and after they're gunned down, when they were supposed to have had weaponry, and then they find out there were no weapons at all. I said, that's a tragedy. And I think a lot of these police officers need to really be re-educated, disciplined, and a lot of them need to be straight up fired because a lot of them can't control themselves. He says, I agree with you. I said, but there is one thing that I must say that I've seen amongst several of my brothers who have been gunned down. He said, what's that? I said, they resisted arrest. You see, I'm the father of two young black boys. And I can't ignore that. And therefore, I had to educate my sons. I said, listen, when a police officer tells you, get down on the ground, I said, that is not your time to fight him. Because you're in his territory. And we have already seen in this world today that they can take a story and turn it around any way they want. So the world is not fair. So therefore, son, I need you to exercise wisdom. When a police officer tells you to get down on the ground, you know what you tell him? Yes, sir. I said, you get down on the ground. If he tells you to put your hands behind your back, you know what you say to him? Yes, sir. And my son was smart. He said, Daddy, he said, but isn't it wrong? I said, listen, it may very well be wrong. I said, but you know what? I said, it's not that we're going to fight. It's just that we're going to pick and choose when we fight. I said, at that moment on the street, when it's just you and him, it's foolish to fight him. Because we have seen in our world that things can be taken advantage of, stories can be told, and stories can be twisted. And when one guy is dead and the other guy is alive, you can't get the whole story. You understand? So one of the things that I had to say is I said, I wish that some of my brothers would have maintained a little bit more patience when those officers were aggravating them. And they felt like, why don't you leave me alone? Why don't you go away? If I could have been there with the camera taping it, I would have said, brother, don't fight it now. Just do what they tell you to do. Don't fight it now. Just do what they tell you to do. We'll fight it, but we'll fight it when you get to go back home to your family. Don't fight it right now on their territory. And therefore, I have learned that both classes, we are finding that individuals need to learn real patience. They need to know how to possess themselves. They need to know how to have a control over their temper and their words, because sometimes just the words you say might cost you your life. That's the world we live in, brothers and sisters. You got to be smart. You got to fight wisely. It's not that you don't fight, you just fight smart. And you don't fight right on the territory right there. So therefore, I love this, because the more that I understand the mind of God is the more that I can learn, man, even Jesus one time went before his destroyers like a sheep that didn't say anything. There were times that Jesus knew, I know when to fight my fights. Jesus knew, I know when I need to speak up, and I know when I'm just not going to say anything. We got to learn that wisdom. And you'd be amazed at how it will spare you in a lot of practical life circumstances. The mind of God. That's what the Bible introduces to us. Well, understanding the creation week. The Bible, did you know the Bible lets us know that we are not a result of an accident? The Bible tells us very clearly, for he spake and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast. And therefore, when we look at that beautiful creation week, we can see God speaking things to existence. Let there be light. Open air. Then he would go ahead and create the plant kingdom. Then he would introduce the constellations. Then he made the sea creatures. Then he made the land. And then he rested. And you get to look at that beautiful creation week, and we begin to understand, I'm not made by accident. I am made by design. The Bible lets people know. You know how many young people need to do that? You know how many young people have convinced themselves that they are worthless, and as a result of that, they put guns to their head? But if we can let them know that they were brought in this world by a divine creator that had a design when he brought them into this planet, can you imagine what that would do to a young man's mind? You see, we're forgetting a lot of these principles. Some of us get so stuck on just different principles of truth. But if we learn to take the Bible as a whole, you would see that the Word of God is literally the solution to all of life's problems. Understanding the origin of languages. The Bible even teaches this. Think about it. In Genesis 11, 1 through 9, the different languages of the world began at the Tower of Babel. Before that, everybody spoke the same language. There was no such thing as Spanish and French and Haitian and Indian and all these other things. There was no such thing as that. Everybody spoke the same language. The origin of the different languages came right there in Genesis, the 11th chapter. All of these things. So why does the Bible have such universal appeal? Number one, the reason why is because the word is a light unto my path and a lamp unto our feet. What is another reason why it has such universal appeal? These things have I spoken unto you, that your joy might be full. Did you know following the Word of God, contrary to popular opinion, following the Word of God, it literally produces and maintains happiness in your life. Do you know where the greatest miseries of life come from? Disobeying the Word of God. This is why Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. The Bible says, in the image of God created he them. You were not made in the image of monkeys. You were not made in the image of tadpoles and amphibians. You were made in the image of God in the beginning. When man fell, we now came in man's image. And therefore, when Christ came, he came to recreate the image of God in you and in me. God says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. All of these blessings come, and that's why the Bible has such universal appeal. This is why so many follow it. And of course, the great Christian's hope, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. This is the Christian's hope. And therefore, this is why the Bible has such universal appeal. It reaches man's heart like no other book can. No other book can. And I know this to be so because what evidence is Bible inspiration found in the lives of people? Think about it. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Behold, old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. The changed lives of those who follow Jesus and obey Scripture constitute the most heartwarming proof of Bible inspiration. Think about it. The drunkard becomes sober, the immoral pure, the addicted free, the profane reverent, the fearful courageous, and the rude kind. All of these things take place when an individual beholds the Word of God and begins to see it. And the reason I know these things to be so, the reason I can speak about it both with passion, excitement, and conviction is because it was over 22 years ago that was me right there. That was my crew. Back in the days in New York, I was not about the Bible. I hated the Bible. I hated religion, and I especially hated Christianity. I felt Christians were a group of hypocrites that were happy in their hypocrisy. And I did not want to have anything to do with Christians. And at this time in my life, I said, man, listen, I'm about to be famous because I watched all these rap videos and everything else. And I said, you know what? Why watch the rap videos if I can be in the rap video? So I started going to auditions in Manhattan and I started looking to dance with all these celebrities. And next thing you know, I won. I started to become a dancer for Queen Latifah, a dancer for Brandy, a dancer for Heavy D, and a whole group of hip hop artists. I started dancing for guys like Busta Rhymes and Tribe Called Quest. These guys were people I hung out with, traveled on tour with, would travel all throughout the US and dance on stage and be part of the parties and the clubs. And I was making money. I was making more money than I've ever made in my life. I made more money in a month than most people made in a year. And here it is that I'm traveling, I'm on television, I'm in music videos, I'm doing all this stuff. Started working with the Wu-Tang Clan, started working with all these different incredible rap groups, started getting on television, started doing Sprite and Coca-Cola commercials, started doing Nike commercials, started to appear on television. And it was right at the height of my career that somebody introduced me to the Word of God. It was right at the height of my career, at the height, not at my failure, at the height of my career. Somebody came to me and said, Dwayne, you need the Word. And I was like, I don't need the Word. I don't need nothing. And God allowed some events to take place. My nephew got gunned down and killed. And when he got killed, that death of my nephew got me thinking about life. And as a result of that, that's when the Word of God came to my heart. And I started to study the Bible. And let me tell you something. I studied the Bible so hard, I started saying, man, I thought this book was a book filled with dead letters. But I found that it was a living Word that literally watered my soul. And I was floored because 22 years ago, I was 20 years old. So I'm a 20-year-old young brother, very successful. I can get any woman I want practically. I had more than enough money to do anything I wanted to do. I had everything. And here it is, somebody says, the Word of God. And when I started studying the Bible, I finally found something that fed my heart more than anything else in this world. And I literally remember when I finally got to a point that I had to call Queen Latifah. I had to call Brandy. I had to call all of them and say, listen, my career is over. God has called me to this life, and I realized the world and Christ cannot mix. And I went and I walked away from that fame, that money, and that everything. And here it is, 22 years later, and now here it is. I'm still traveling the world. Isn't that something? I didn't ask for this. I did not ask for this. I did not give my heart to the Lord that I may travel the world. I was just happy to meet a man named Jesus. That was it. That was my satisfaction. And then God, and I started doing Bible studies, called my boy Damien. I said, Damien, he was my dancing partner. I said, D, you got to hear this message, man. He said, what you got? Shared the Bible with him. Damien got baptized. Damien got baptized. Me and Damien said, all right, brother, we slapped five. We said, we're going to light the streets of New York up like Elijah and Elisha. We started going all throughout the streets of New York, and we started sharing the Bible with everybody. We started going to subways, having Bible studies. Individuals were joining the church, getting baptized. And one day, Damien called me and said, hey, man, I met a young lady. I'm going to bring her to the Bible study tonight. I said, no problem. Bring it on. Met the young lady, and that young lady was my wife. Did a Bible study with my wife. Studied with her. She got baptized. Studied with her sister. She got baptized. Studied with her brother. He got baptized. And next thing you know, we all just started growing in grace. And one day, God put it in my heart to ask her to, in courtship, we courted together. After about a year and a half, we got married. And then the Lord blessed us with four precious children. Started learning how to do business and all these things. And then one day, God says, I'm calling you out of the business world, son. I need you for me full time. I said, Lord, I don't want to go. Y'all don't understand. I resisted the work that I do today. I said, Father, I don't want to do this. And God says, I'm calling you. And he kept calling, and he kept calling. And I ran for 2 years. And then finally, I couldn't do it anymore. I said, Lord, all right, I am yours. I remember I walked out of my job with that box in my hand, all of my belongings. I gave a whole bunch of Bible readings for the home. I gave all sorts of books to my coworkers. You know, I'm not leaving without leaving a memorial. And I left there, and I remember looking up in the sky, and I said, all right, Lord, I'm yours now. What you gonna do with me? And God had great plans, because it's been 6 years that I have been in full-time, self-supporting gospel ministry. And God has privileged me to be with my family, that my wife, my children, and ourselves, we work together in ministry. And I remember flying on a plane, and one day a man was there, and he was a businessman. He was like, so what do you do for a living? I said, I'm in the assurance business. And he says, insurance? I said, no, I didn't say insurance. I said, assurance. And he's like, what are you talking about? I said, blessed assurance. You know, just started to go ahead and share the word with him. And he says, you know, and he said, wow, this is what you do for a living. I said, yes, sir. And I was on my way to another country. And I said to him, I said, sir, you know, he said, so what did you do before this? I said, well, I used to work at a company. And he said, really? And I said, yeah, I said, I used to make a great six-figure income. Great six-figure income, man. And he was like, really? And he said, you walked away from all of that? I said, yes, I did. He says, how do you feel about all this? I said, are you kidding me? I said, this is the happiest chapter of my life. And he says, you know what? I don't have what you have. And we began to talk, and God allowed me to be a witness to this brother. All I'm saying is, when you understand what is contained in here, when you understand that God put life in between these pages, and when these words are studied and read and practiced, God says there are blessings that its highest value will only be realized in eternity. God says, why would you reject this? Therefore, I simply ask you the question. Would you be willing to say that I accept the word of God, the Bible, as the authority over my life and will live my life according to its principles? Now, if your answer is yes, you will notice that there's a little paper that all of you should have had. And on this little paper, if your answer is yes to the study tonight, I am simply going to ask that you just put a little check mark on the right side of your page here. Just put a little check mark on the right side of your paper if your answer is yes. Now, make sure your name is there. We want to know who you are. We like praying for people. So make sure your name is there. Make sure your contact information is there. You see the questions that are there. If you'd like Bible study, anything like that, you can put the check boxes where they are appropriate. But we want you to go ahead and put that little check mark right there. And as you put that check mark right there, now if there's somebody who says, I don't have one of those, just raise your hand now so we can make sure you get it. But if you're saying that, yes, I accept the word of God, the Bible, as the authority. Now, keep that in mind now. That means the authority. That means it's not your life anymore. You're not going to do what you want to do. Everything you do must be based on that blessed word. And if that's the decision you're making tonight, then I want you to put that little check mark right on the right side of your paper here. And then as you leave, our usher will be in the back, and we just simply want you to take those papers and put it in the hand. The usher will have a basket. Just put those papers in that basket. And we're going to be praying for you that God will sustain you, that this book, the Word of God, the Bible, will be the authority in your life. Amen? Now, if it has been your decision, then why don't we so signify? After you put that check on your paper, why don't you so signify as we all now go to our knees together and close out in prayer? Father in heaven, we are so grateful that while we live in a world where there seems to be nothing that we can trust, we are so grateful that there is still something we can trust, and it's called the Bible. A book so old, a book that has been through so many wars, a book that has gone through battle after battle, even today, and yet still rises above the rest and shines brightly and beautiful. And only if we can receive this word in our heart. This is your love letter that you have given to us. And Lord, we have rejected this letter. But we're grateful that tonight we can read it once again, study it once again, get to know you as it is our privilege to know you, for you have revealed yourself in your word. And I pray that as you reveal yourself, may we as a people, by beholding, become changed into the same image of what we behold. We praise you and thank you so much that you have heard this prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to wish you all a good night. And God bless you. Please make sure you fill out the paper, and then we're going to ask our ushers in the back that if you could have a tray that everyone can place their papers in. Please do not leave without filling out that paper, putting the check mark on the upper right-hand side, and then placing that paper in the basket or in the hands in the back of our usher. We thank you very much. May God bless and keep you. And we look forward to seeing you tomorrow night. No, we look forward to seeing you Friday night. God bless you.